the meeting to order, and do we have a full house here? Do we need any?
Who is there?
Well, Josh isn't here.
Josh?
Oh, Josh is here.
Hi, Josh, how are you?
I haven't seen Josh for so long, I don't recognize him.
This agenda's not gonna work.
Well, you're sitting on the wrong end of the table, too.
So only Jenny isn't here.
Right.
And she's an alternate, so anyway, we have a full house of commission members, so we don't have to seat any alternates. I'd like to hear a motion to change the order of the agenda from the public hearing to applications for zoning permits.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So, applications for zoning permits, is there anything we ought to?
We have none at this point, the one that I have one pending, but it did not arrive in time to be put on the agenda.
Except the,
That's a sculpture down at the Trinity Episcopal Conference Center, yes.
Right.
It's there, but it's not where the zoning permit says it's gonna be.
Right.
So that is.
So that's that?
That's that.
Okay, and then I'd like to ask for a motion to change the order of the agenda to item two, approval of minutes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So the December 8th regular meeting minutes. Any comments on that? I just have a tiny question, but did Mr. McCowan hand out?
Yes, he did.
At the meeting?
Yes. And he just.
Well, I don't know if they know what I'm talking about.
The conflict of interest, some of you got copies, he just emailed it to me.
Recusals. No, I'm just wondering about the, if he acted.
He did.
It says he circulated the guideline.
And now I have it on my computer.
Okay.
So the guidelines are now available, they're sitting all on my computer.
So are there any comments or corrections about the December 8th minutes? Hearing none, can I hear a motion to approve the December 8th minutes?
I move we approve the December 8th minutes as they are.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And now I'd like to ask for a motion to.
Why don't?
To change the order of the agenda to a new applications, item three, and then we can go to item five, six, and
we could do seven too.
Instead of ahead of the public hearing.
So.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so new applications?
No.
Okay. Item five, correspondence and communications received.
You all received the package of the correspondence that is up on the website. There's two more pieces that have been made part of the record, they're part of the packages. One is from Susan Claw, 280 Cream Hill Road, and the other one is from Elizabeth Tobin. So those are now part of the record as well.
Okay.
came in via email today, so I will bundle those up and put those back on the website after, when I finish up with tonight's minutes. So that's the new communications received. I hope that, thank you, Richard and Laszlo, that they were very kind to get the special permit application up in its entirety, as well as all the correspondence that you received in that PDF. It's been up since Monday. So if anybody had any questions, they could read everything that you had.
Thank you. Okay, so that's that. On to item six.
The only thing I wanted to address under my, and I keep all your package here, sorry about that, and then I'll pass it back to you, is that it is budget time.
Right.
If you go into the middle of your package, you will see it. You are one of the three boards and commissions that is under the land use budget, as well as me, the person that is the zoning and wetlands enforcement officer, land use administrator, and the land use clerk, the three functions that I perform for all three boards. As you will see, this was prepared at the end of December for me, so it doesn't reflect everything. It doesn't reflect a couple things that have come in, including Tom Gowan's consulting fees for the first 6 months and legal fees, for which there is have been legal fees incurred for the Zoning Board of Appeals for the Cornwall Inn appeal. I feel personally, based on what I see coming up in the next 6 months, being that this is a land use budget for three boards, I do not foresee that there will be extensive legal fees, because everything that we've had some issues with the Inland Wetlands Commission with some ongoing issues, but thankfully, and I say this through the grace of God, both of them have been resolved amicably and with everybody working together to resolve the issues, including the Nash Pond, which would have been a really big one if we had to gain possession of the dam to have it fixed. Dennis McMorrow has also been a great consultant to me, because he's working with the property owner. So, as the legal fees, as much as they're high for this year, I don't think that they are out of line with a $2,500 budget item for next year. Consulting services, the $6,800 that we have, is going to be adequate. I think Goldman in New York has picked up a fair amount of Tom's work. Mileage, that can stay the same. That's pretty much my mileage, or for me to pay for any of you folks if you want to go to meetings. And that does include fees to go to meetings as well. Printing, I do most of my own printing. I have expended some on your zoning regulations. I'll be doing most of them myself, and putting them up on the website means that I don't have to print as much. The one thing that I want to point out to you is legal notices. I put in $1,800. I thought it would be best to explain this, because a lot of people do not understand process in terms of what goes through my office. We have several kinds of applications, and that in all three boards, you can have public hearings. You can have a public hearing for the Zoning Board of Appeals, whether it be an appeal against a decision of the zoning enforcement officer or a variance. There can be public hearings set for inland wetlands, and as you know, we have public hearings set here for all special permits. We have, and this is frankly, Gordon and I discussed this several years ago when we had to bump numbers up. We have kept the application fee for public hearings at $150, so as to encourage people to come and they need to do. All public hearings require three legal notices, two prior, one after. The fee now to put a legal notice in the Republican American is about $80. So right off the bat, we exceed the $150 fee that we collect. In addition, the state of Connecticut, in their infinite wisdom, has a fee for all land use applications, wetlands, ZBA, zoning permits, and special permits. That fee was about 10 years ago, $10, $8 to the state, $2 to the town. It went to $20. 18 to the state, and another year it went to 30, and then it was bounced to 60. Every zoning permit that comes in, I collect a $75 fee. The first $58 goes to the state of Connecticut. That's for all wetlands permits and ZBA applications. So your special permit applications beside in that $150 fee is three public hearings plus the $58 to the state. So I wanted you to be aware of that. If we are looking at regulatory changes, which is going to cause legal notices to skyrocket from what I figure is usually around 8 to 10 a year, that line item really needs to be adjusted. But I thought you should know that that is a cost of processing applications in my office. And those fees have to be paid on a quarterly basis. As a land use administrator, I'm obligated to do that, provide it to the bookkeeper so that we are in compliance with state regulations and not incurring fees. But that's pretty much the budget. I wanted to run that past you so that if you have any questions, I would be glad to answer them. Oh, I do have to point one other thing out. Rick Lynn from the Northwest Cog will be coming to our planning meeting a week from Saturday. He will be addressing the fact that there's some new rules regarding the preparation of plans of conservation and development, the fact that the state is changing the process so that everybody's plan is more consistent from the local level to the state level, and I think he will be talking about how the COG can possibly help, or if there's going to be money available to help towns in terms of plans of conservation development. You're 5 years and away, and you started 2 or 3 years in advance, so you're probably looking at funding, and I'm looking at Gordon, but he's looking down. In the past, there's been a capital funding for the preparation of your plan. That's something that you can hopefully report and we'll have some good news about. So that's it.
On the fee aspect that you were talking with us about, do you have any ballpark idea in the past year? Maybe it's in the indicated here in the numbers, how much more we spent in as part of the Cornwall's obligation in comparison to the charges that
we were
able to levy?
With every special permit or public hearing that we have, we basically balance, we lose about $100, but there's the fees that I collect, the $75 fees is in a separate account. The only thing that technically comes out of my account is the legal notices, but that's in the $150 fee that goes in. So
if we start to have a lot, that would add up.
Yeah, exactly. And I have to be really honest, a lot of towns, the regulatory process, I know there are some towns that, for instance, a wetlands public hearing is $500. Mm. And they're very quick to set somebody for a hearing. You don't have a lot of hearings set by your wetlands commission. The last one is a regulatory change. It's pretty much ZBA and PNC that, you know, expense that line.
And I'm sorry, when is my budget start date?
Mr. Ridgway, do I have to have it to you by the end of the month?
Yes.
Fiscal year?
June
30th. July 1st is the start. Yeah. So these year-to-dates are roughly halfway through? Right.
Tom has not given me a bill for his services for the first 6 months, and the legal fees expense item is over-expended, but it's not... it's not to the point that it couldn't be balanced with some other things. Because I don't think Tom is going to spend $1,600. At the end of the year, Gordon, and I am correct in saying this, this budget, the land use budget, is looked at. As much as I have line items, I try to make sure if I see that there's something going up in one, I try to balance it at this point in time. I do not expect that I'm going to spend computer, much of office supplies or whatever, so I'm going to cut back. and I only put in the time that was needed to run my office. I have respectful, Gordon has been respectful to me, I've been respectful, I think, to the town, to try and be fair.
Any other questions about the budget?
Karen, did you say that Tom McGowan has, I'm sorry if I misunderstood this, has yet to bill us for his services
for the first 6 months?
Fiscal year to date.
Yeah, that has not been that much because of what, you know, your economic development charge has been much more with Goldman and York, the EDC, through their grant funding. They've been doing a lot more of the work, I would say, than Tom has been asked to do. I always kiddingly ask him for his bill at the end of December so he can buy his wife a diamond ring for Christmas, but I guess she can get it again this year. So, he will, I'm sure he'll have it to me.
Right, right. I was just wondering if, I don't know, it drives me crazy when people don't send me bills for 6 months and then suddenly I get a bill, you know, and it doesn't sound like that's necessarily the case, but maybe.
I don't have a problem with Tom.
Okay.
I pretty much know.
All right, that's fine. That's fine.
Okay, is that it for your home report?
Yep.
We have
Amy here, and I never pronounced your name right.
But
so.
I think we're, maybe we could just, okay, it's a week. Can I hear a motion to go to the public hearing?
So moved.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. So, the script and the recorder.
We're set to go.
Recorder's going.
Does everybody have a script? I've got 8 copies, so we can pass them down.
Yeah. I don't know why everyone needs it, but okay. Okay. The following is a. Sorry, before you talk. Okay. The following is a. Combined hearing for the Cornwall Planning and Zoning Commission. The hearings will please come to order. I am David Colbert, Chairman of the Planning and Zoning Commission and Chairman for the hearing. In compliance with state law, a transcript must be made of everything said at any public hearing of a Planning and Zoning Commission. We are doing this by means of a digital voice recorder, which is now on. For the purpose of the record, let me state that it is now 7:25 p.m. on January 12th, 2016. The members of the Planning and Zoning Commission who are present tonight are regular members, Peter Combs, Jill Cutler, James Laporta, Josh Tyson, Steve Sicardi, and myself, and alternate members who are not seated for the hearing, but are here, are Anna Tamel and Dermot Wood. The purpose of these hearings, duly advertised according to law, is to hear the applications of SP 237, Amelia Niergard and Rinker Buck, owners applicants, special permits for a bed and breakfast establishment, section 8.13, room and board, or a bed and breakfast establishment, and section 8.19, 56 Essex Hill Road. The follow, and so I'll just ask Karen to now read.
Well, I will, as I just referenced, a legal notice which was published in the Waterbury Republican according to statutory times twice. No more than 15 days, no less than 2 days prior to the hearing. It was published December 31st and January 7th. It reads legal notice, Town of Cornwall, notice of public hearings, Planning and Zoning Commission. The Planning and Zoning Commission will hold public hearings to be heard concurrently. The reason that I'm saying public hearings is that they were folded in one for two to hear the following applications. SP 237, Amelia D. Neergard and Rinka Buck, owner, applicant special permits for bed and breakfast establishment, section 813, room and board for a bed and breakfast establishment, and section 819, home occupation, 56 Essex Hill Road. At these public hearings, interested persons may hear and be heard and written communications received. Copy of the proposed applications on file and available for review in the Land Use Office, dated the 17th day of December 2015, by myself, Karen Griswold Nelson, Land Use Administrator. The file contains a copy of the signed application. You have copies. This application is also up on the website. There's a site plan that shows the location of the house as cited, including all of the connections to the accessory buildings, the assessor's card showing the layout of the property and how it is assessed, and then the narrative that was prepared by Amy that basically addresses the special permits being requested and their compliance with the general specific standards of the application. I'm going to quickly segue off of the script and say, and also a letter from abutting neighbor Catherine Fetterman. The receipts of the certified mails to the three abutters, which is Catherine Fetterman, Sam Waterston, and the land and service in Middletown, are on file in my office. I just wanted to quickly say, because we talked about it at last month's meeting, the special permit, when you are looking at this applications, you have your general criteria and your specific criteria, and her narrative addresses that. If you read through it, if you have any questions, because as we talked about, that you have to address all of those, as you've been very well taught. So I'm gonna leave it up to David. I'm not sure if Amy would like to, she's in attendance, to address the commission, and would you like me to read your narrative into the record, or would you like to read it yourself? I talk fast, so.
You talk fast? If you're comfortable reading, that's fine.
Why don't you do it?
You'd rather have me?
Yeah, this is more than you have to speak.
Okay, just read the narrative that
I have? Yeah, come on up here so we can hear it. Oh! Process first, and then you can open the floor to the public.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll hear from the applicant.
Yep.
I'm applying for a special permit to use my family residence as a B&B and to hold occasional art classes for small groups of children and or adults. My house is located off a main road with easy accessibility via a flat paved driveway for fire and police protection. Special permit uses will not change the outward appearance of the house, which is consistent with the existing character of the neighborhood. The neighborhood is sparsely populated and there are no immediate neighbors. The house has ample parking for 8 to 10 cars in the paved area in front and to the side of the two garages. The house has a working septic system designed for a 6-bedroom, 5.5-bathroom house. My family and I have lived here for 20 years. When we bought the house, it was divided into several sections. There was a 2-floor accessory apartment in one wing with 2 bedrooms, a kitchen, living room, and 2 full baths. There was a shipping and storage workshop in another wing for the children's clothing store owned by the house owner across the street. There was an additional apartment suite for an invalid aunt. There was also a greenhouse and extensive growing tables for seedlings in the basement. I mention these uses to show that this house has been from the beginning a center of activity, business, and a multifamily dwelling. We turned it back into a one-family house using the extra spaces for home offices and an art studio. There will be no storage, use, or disposal of hazardous materials in either of the special permit uses of the residence. All art activities involve safe, traditional art materials. I plan to rent rooms on a nightly basis. I have three guest rooms, which are only occasionally used by my family. There are two full bathrooms adjacent to these rooms. I will use Airbnb to book and promote the rooms, as well as referrals from friends. I do not plan to advertise or put up any signs, although I would like to reserve the right to do so. This is a part-time business for me and is still primarily my family's home. I have been renting rooms through Airbnb for about 2 years and have averaged 60 nights of bookings per year. That translates into 5 nights per month. Usually booking is for one couple for one night. Occasionally I will rent 2 or 3 rooms at the same time for 1 or 2 nights. Most bookings are on weekends. For much of the year, there is very little tourist traffic in Cornwall. The busiest months are June through October, when I have a rental almost every weekend. For the other 7 months, I have almost no guests. I've only had one couple stay overnight with me to ski at Mohawk Ski Area, even though my house is practically across the street. I've had very good experiences with Airbnb and have found the guests to be respectful, considerate, and friendly. I have hosted many European and Asian travelers who tell me that Airbnb is more common abroad. Quite a few of my guests have also been hosts. Airbnb encourages many safety precautions, sending homeowners free fire and carbon monoxide detectors, first aid kits, and emergency phone number cards to display. Their booking system allows you to check the profile and reviews of each guest before you accept them to stay with you. It is customary to exchange emails with that person too before they book a room. The flexibility of scheduling allows me to easily block rooms if I will be away or have friends and family staying with me. Each host is also covered by a generous liability insurance plan through Airbnb to cover any damage that might be caused by guests. I do not serve breakfast and have found that most Airbnb travelers do not expect it. But with a B&B permit, it would be nice to be able to offer coffee and a simple breakfast if requested. The use of my studio for art classes would be an occasional activity, perhaps 3 or 4 times a year for 2 to 5 days. Classes would be small, usually no more than 10 children and or adults. The studio has a sink and a bathroom, a screened porch, and a separate entrance from the outside. In the past, I have held children's art classes sporadically, mostly in the summer. Respectfully submitted, Amelia DeLuca.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Now, are there any questions anyone on the commission has for the applicant? Question I have is under the room and board regulation 8.12.5, it says the health official shall certify that the existing or the existing or proposed modified subsurface sewage disposal system is adequate to serve the use.
I spoke to Kathy Weber today. In July, a letter was sent to you. It was also made part of the ZBA file from Area Health regarding their permitting for bed and breakfast. When I spoke to Kathy today, we again agreed that if and when this permit is approved, then all they have to do is flag their files in Torrington that it is being used as a bed and breakfast, and that information would come in and be part of the file for the bed and breakfast for me, and it would be a condition of approval of that that certification be put on file in the town hall.
Okay.
So I'm sorry, Karen. The Torrington Area Health would, as part of this process, send any information to you that they have regarding the septic system.
Yeah.
What if
she's off.
On this, but I'm talking sort of more broadly.
Normally, we would ask for Torrington Area Health. In this case, I knew that this had already been vetted, so I just clarified today that this is, you know, she has a working septic system, and that we just have to flag the file, something that I frankly wouldn't have thought of before.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because I'm reading this letter from Tom Stansfield, dated August 18th, where he says, blah, 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 by definition, less than 16 persons not regulated as a public water supply. The premise behind both a B&B and Airbnb is the accommodations take place in existing bedroom space, and therefore sewage disposal should not be a concern. Which, it makes sense that, you know, a home has got six bedrooms and theoretically the system is designed for that. I'm just wondering, like, in the event that there isn't any information, would that hold somebody up? You know, I mean, if it predates 1980 or so, the records are pretty sketchy. And
in the past, there's, since I've been here, there's been one other bed and breakfast permit that was up on Kent Road, and there was renovations going on in the house, so there was information in the file from Torrington Area Health. It always is a good thing to check, and we've done due diligence. Yeah.
I have a question about, there is a pool. Is that going to be available to the guests or? Okay.
No. It's not, it hasn't been used for 5 years, and when I have had children there, I put a padlock on it.
Okay.
And any other questions from the commission?
In 812.2, it mentions parking, or maybe you did discuss it.
I said that there's enough parking for 8 to 10 cars.
Okay. Yeah, and their standard is one car for 4 people, so.
Right.
Yeah.
And on, in terms of the home occupation, are you planning to have employees? And there's a, it says you're able to have up to 2 employees,
right?
You know, working.
When I have done this in the past, I've had one helper, you know, and
yeah.
I've co-taught with another artist.
So it wouldn't be more than two.
No.
Additional. And perhaps if one of those was a member of the family, you'd be able to have another.
Oh,
because, yeah, non-resident.
Okay.
Does that have to be included in the materials in the application? It does, doesn't it?
I'm not sure if when your wife did the application for your house, we made sure that she included a few employees in there, whether she would ever need them or not.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think it's just to save us the, save the trouble of having to come back and ask that.
Right. So I'm allowed to have one employee now, or two. And if I co-teach with someone else, is that then we are?
Two employees plus a family member.
Tom, you're probably studying something else now, but
I can multitask.
We have an application for a general home occupation. And it says in our regs that there, it's those working on the residential lot shall be limited to the resident members of the immediate family and no more than 2 non-resident persons. Do you think the applicant has to specify at the time of the public hearing how many employees they're going to have, or is this just if we approve the general home occupation, they're just allowed to have.
Normally, a description of what's being proposed would include whether or not they're going to have employees and if how many.
And if, okay.
They may want to say that I don't know, but in the rule of two would apply.
Okay, so it would be helpful to have some kind of statement of intent.
Okay.
Or at least provisionally.
Right.
Yeah,
I mean, it doesn't have to be written in stone, but if you don't, it's easier if we put it in now.
Yeah. Okay, well, I think I would do what I've done in the past, which is just have one person that I co-teach with and an assistant to help her any need.
Okay, so okay.
So that would fit that
she could just sign that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then if one of my children helps out, which they have done in the past, that would not be counted, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Non-resident. Unless, I guess, their residents are somewhere else, then,
right.
Yeah, then they'd be, I guess, an employee.
So even though they're my children, if they're not living there full time, they're not, I can't count them?
Well, it's
it's they're always little houses.
Yeah.
You know,
I think it's their official address.
On regs, it says non-resident.
Non-resident employees and immediate family members.
They're immediate family members.
Right, so sure. Whether they live with you or not, they're immediate family members. Pretty well. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think.
Okay. I'll take that. Yeah.
So you're modifying your narrative to say one, in terms of your art classes, business, one person, co-teacher, one assistant helper, and that family members would be allowed. Is that what we're saying?
Yes.
Now, are there any other questions for the applicant from anyone on the commission? And is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak in favor of the application?
Sure, I'll speak in favor. Just I'm here, can't shut up.
Please identify yourself.
Gordon Ridgway, just speaking as an individual, and just think this is a great idea. Having grown up in the area, knowing that there used to be business up there called the Children's Cottage, and ever since that went out of business, the children of this town have been deprived of activity, and now Amy will bring back some activity for kids with her proposal, so I think she should be applauded and approved for taking the initiative. Thank you.
Okay. And is there anyone from the audience who would like to speak in opposition to the application? Is there any other questions or comments from the commission?
I just noticed on the application it's specified in section 8.13, but it's actually 8.12. I believe it's the
in our new
room and board.
Vigilant.
I think we cut and pasted them.
Otherwise, we're looking at roadside police stands.
Well, it's a good thing I put all the language in as to what it is.
Well, then, can I hear?
David, could I just ask Amy a question?
Sure.
That I think might be helpful for the board to know. Well, how many, I thought there was an excellent narrative and there's a big package of materials. Mm-hmm. How many hours of preparation did it take you to put together this application?
It was basically just writing this and talking to the Board of Health in Torrington, finding out if anything was required. So it was an hour to write this, was like an hour and a half. Meeting with Karen a couple times to find out how this works and what I have to do. So I would say 5-6 hours.
A day?
Huh?
Probably
a day. A day. But it was over a period of time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So can I hear a motion to approve application SP? Oh, right, sorry.
Okay.
Can I hear a...
Thank you, everybody.
Can I hear a motion to close the public hearing SP 237?
So moved.
Is there a second?
I second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. And can I hear a motion heading on to item 4 on the agenda, pending applications? This doesn't have to be recorded, but I hear a motion to approve application SP 237, which in the same application folds in the special permit for a bed and breakfast establishment and the home occupation.
I move that we approve application SP 237 for both the bed and breakfast and the home occupation.
And do we want to say pending Torrington area health?
I don't. I don't think we need to, right? Don't they have?
Well, I think if, number one, you're approving it as for the site plan, as for the narrative, and the amended site plan, amended narrative, and with the condition that the Torrington area health certification of the special of the bed and breakfast establishment be filed in land records after the approval.
Yeah.
Okay, I add that as an addition to the motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
And as part of the motion, you have agreed that this application complies with the general standards and specific standards of the sections referenced mostly correctly, and the sections of your general standards that impact your neighborhood, et cetera, because you know why I'm asking that you agree to that.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amy.
And thank you, Amy, for being so cooperative in terms of you know, being made a little bit of a guinea pig here. So.
Thank you for your help.
Okay.
Can I take a couple of minutes just to rehash this septic thing on bed and breakfast in general, because I'm just fixated on these sorts of things.
I have a diagram. No,
he's
not you. Not you.
Nothing to do with you. It just seems that what Tom Stansfield, who is the director of area health, outlined in his letter of August 18th is a little different than what Kathy said to you. And I know and respect Kathy very well. She's sometimes zealous, shall we say. And it very clearly says that the premise between Airbnb is that accommodations take place in existing bedroom space, and therefore sewage disposal should not be a concern. Any additions to the number of bedrooms in a home would need to be approved by area health. The exceptions to this would be that if the system was found to be in failure as defined in the applicable regulations, in which case the property owner would be ordered to repair or replace the septic system. Doesn't say anything about flagging any files or making sure that septic systems are fully functional or anything. It says you've got 4 bedrooms, 2 of them are empty, rent them out. I mean, that's kind of what it says. And so I'm wondering, I don't want somebody who has no information on their house because their septic system predates 1980 to have to go through a whole bunch of verification on their septic systems to
which
rent out a bedroom once
which
in a while.
They can't get.
Well, it's very difficult without digging the thing up and seeing
what's
there.
Yeah.
So I don't want this to hold someone else up. I mean, Amy's fortunate that she has some records, but
a lot. We have to modify our regulation.
Our regulation?
But Josh, isn't this for a bed and breakfast?
This is for a bed and breakfast.
And so he wasn't, I mean, I may have been skimming or something, but the bulk of his comments are about Airbnb.
Well, that's a bed and breakfast.
No, it's not.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
No, I mean, he goes into, you know, less than 25 people or something, and then anything over 25 people is considered a public utility and you need to have water tests. But
currently for our regs, our current regs.
And Anna just pointed that out to me.
The only time this has to, is triggered, is if someone's applying for a bed and breakfast.
Right.
So it's...
So,
it seems to me that when the reg was written was obviously before passed.
Jim, he can't hear you.
It seems that when our regs were written, it was before Tom Stanfield's letter came out. So this might be a new policy of them saying they don't really don't need to look at this situation, whereas we already have in our regulation a line that says we should look at the situation.
Right, right.
So probably moving forward, I would think we should reevaluate our requirements for the room and board regulation and also verify with Tom Stanfield or Torrington Area Health that they don't need to look at it, in which case then we can just take it out of our regulations.
Right.
It wouldn't be a requirement in the future. But since this obviously is in there now, until that happens, we would still have to look at that requirement as well.
Thank you. Philosophically, I would like to address the fact that a lot of people for zoning permits, for anybody coming in, for instance, a zoning permit for an entire house or for a 10 by 20 shed has to go to Torrington Area Health. And people, a lot of people feel it's onerous. Seems to be kind of, you know, different set of rules. And in all of the discussion about short-term rentals and house rentals, the question has come up, would a lot of people believe that there is far more supervision of septic systems than is allowed by, you know, state regulations and what have you. When I asked Kathy Weber to address Airbnbs and what have you, she gave this to Tom Stansfield, who's at Sanitarium, and he wrote a very thoughtful letter that could be used for reference and give some guidance so that when people assume that there's some sort of connection between the number of people living in a house and bedrooms or the regularity of a septic system being maintained. There are some things that under zoning there is, I don't count people in a house, it's bedrooms. I don't have mandates that require somebody to pump or inspect the septic system on a regular basis. That's not something that I keep track of. It's not something the area health keeps track. But I think for clarity's sake, because that seems to be a huge concern that that there's failing septic systems or things are being done. And I think if anything, by trying to clear the air and make better records, it results in a lot less anxiety and tension created thinking that people aren't doing what they're supposed to be doing. So philosophically, I don't have a problem with it. It might not be totally whatever, but with the conversations that we're having, it's probably the best way to go right now.
I think it's kind of a red herring.
Which is the best way?
I think that a bedroom's a bedroom, and it doesn't matter if your kid's sleeping there or a paying guest is sleeping
right
there.
Well, I think that's the burden of
what he's
saying.
There's no excess load. I mean, you know, it's all about gallonage. But
and besides, there's an extra fee when you go to the Torrington Area Health District.
Yeah, there's a $45.
Yeah,
for every
I totally understand for the shed, the swimming pool, whatever it is that you're contemplating constructing, you want to make sure that you're not using the best ground for your septic system and putting a swimming pool there instead. I mean, that makes perfect sense.
It does to you. It doesn't to a lot of people.
It should. I mean,
I think it should.
Because you make a lot much smaller when you start plunking things down on it, and suddenly you're...
But we're heading off in a little...
But let me just ask if my perception is correct, that what he's saying is, if you have a working septic system, you're not violating anything, and you don't need extra supervision if the bedrooms are empty and you're renting them. Is that not so?
That's my interpretation.
Yeah.
But can we, I mean, this is going to be part of our
discussion. I just wanted to make sure I understood this.
But I'd like to hear a motion to move on to item 8 on the agenda, the planning.
What about 7?
Well, we're able to do that quickly if we want.
Well, why don't we see if we can do it quickly?
What's the second on this motion?
The motion to approve this application.
Yeah.
It's changed. Okay.
All right. I'm sorry, Maya.
And did we vote on it?
Yes. Yeah.
We did. Okay. Yeah. We did.
Yeah. Yes, they can
Yeah.
Okay.
I didn't vote.
Thank
but
you.
I don't have to.
Okay.
So we had by popular request. To go on to item 7, the draft correspondence concerning the letter to the Cornwall Trust. And so everyone's received that by email, and there were a couple of comments by email, but in the correspondence it just says, if everyone's familiar with it, is everyone familiar enough with the correspondence to the Cornwall, regarding the Cornwall Trust's application?
Yes.
Okay. So, if there was just the only ambiguity is it going to be unanimous or not? So, is there anyone who isn't in favor of this letter? Well then, can I, if we strike the parentheses at the bottom and change the date as James pointed out to the 12th instead of the 13th, the final sentence would read the commission unanimously and enthusiastically supports the Cornwall Conservation Trust application for an open space grant to help purchase the property. Can I hear a motion of our approval for that? Is that a letter? Is there a second?
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
What?
I can, yeah, both of us. We can speculate for a long time about that. Okay, so I can, Karen, I'll be able to print this out and sign and mail it to, I guess.
I think Bart, I think they want the copy. I think they submitted with their package.
So you'll send it? Okay, so I'll mail it too?
Yeah. I think it's part of their package, yeah.
Okay.
You can double check if that's what I was doing with them.
So now, moving on to item 8, planning workshop. I'm thinking, should we skip ahead to a report from the Village Center Subcommittee. Should we speak about that now?
Sure. The only person I haven't heard from is Mr. Peck in terms of approving the subcommittee minutes.
Oh.
snapshot of the meeting. I'm not sure if everyone was over there.
We had a meeting, James and I, Joe was sick, with Gordon and Mr. Hiram Peck, who is the zoning regulatory guru with Goman and York. The discussion was, the agenda included one specific set of changes to the zoning regs that the village center subcommittee had come up with in response to the town plan. And the second agenda item was a more general discussion of how he felt our regulations might be improved upon to be more friendly to businesses in Cornwall. We felt since we had him and had his expertise that we should have him take a look and make suggestions if he had any. And there was a general discussion about what the future economic climate of Cornwall might look like. One of the things that he did say that I sat up and listened to was that he felt that our special permit process could be streamlined to make it more timely and less onerous. But we'll see what he comes up with. And I don't know if Gordon wants to add anything in particular.
Well, I saw him at another meeting in West Cornwall, and I gave him some interviews that Dave Delinsky has done for the Economic Development Committee for Cornwall businesses and things. So anyway, he has some information, and I think he will be there, and we're working on tomorrow setting up procedures. We are having this economic summit on February 5th, 6th, and 9th, where we're going to look at the economy of the villages and the town as a whole, and then Gorman and York, who have been out and about for about a year, will make some recommendations for future steps. And I would assume that Mr. Peck will be there and have a few zoning thoughts. So it seems like that will help move the peanut forward.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so I think we could move on to short-term rentals.
And for the audience there, there's a set of agendas, and on attached to the agenda is the Tom McGowan letter that is in the commission's package. The one letter that is not in there is a preliminary report from Stephen Byrne that I think I had some questions. I was waiting for Steve to call me. But in the meantime, there is, you do have Tom McGowan's report that the commission will be using.
Here's my copy of the
handout.
No. No, here it is. It's tabled. So, Tom, would you want to?
It's in there somewhere.
Would you like to
find a way down the set of the rooms?
Oh,
yeah.
I'm sorry, Tom.
Should the commission consider what kind of options perhaps are there for dealing with this issue? So I did my homework, went like everybody else does on the internet and looked for what kind of reports were out there and findings were out there and activities were out there, particularly relative to small towns, finding very little in that regard and a whole lot regarding cities and larger communities. I spoke with a couple of planners, including Marty Connor over in Tarleton, who also is the planner for Goshen, a small town. Neither of those communities are doing anything relative I also reached out to Attorney Stephen Byrne as per your authorization and my request to do so, because he has cast a broader net and can deal with this from both an extensive knowledge perspective and a legal viewpoint, because I think there are legal fundamental and legal questions with this. At least as it's written or not written in the zoning regulations in Cornwall now. Obviously, having two lawyers to squeeze out over what's being said in the regulation. What I have found in broad terms are nothing earth-shattering, but number one would be, it's very clear, and I think that's important to say at the outset, that the zoning regulations are not clear as regards how to deal with rentals of single-family homes, short-term, long-term, or interim. It does clearly deal with it if you qualify as a B&B or as a rooming board, but those have the factor of serving food, which of course is not a factor for a rental for the whole house, which is the one of the common elements going on here through Airbnb and the like. So ZBA has ruled. You still do not have, I believe, the final formal minutes of that meeting.
That's my understanding. Yeah.
They're convening in 2 weeks.
So procedurally speaking, that being one of my assignments, you really can't take any action on the report till you get it. I said that last time, of course, that just still stands. We do know that they have opined that short-term rentals are not allowed in the regulation.
Action, you mean, in terms of enforcement?
Right. Or how you're going to receive that report and whether you're going to take action on it, or just what you're going to do with it.
Yeah.
As Steve Byrne says, your consulting attorney, however, ZBA rulings regarding enforcement in a particular instance do not establish policy, particularly in a matter where the regulations are completely unclear, as is the case here. So what that means is that this issue, and I think you'll all agree with this, given the fact that there's greatly different opinions within the community about how to deal with it, not clarity of the regulations about how to deal with it, that the whole matter comes back to this commission, first and foremost, as a matter of how to settle the policy. Policy is something that typically goes to the town plan. And I do think, as I've said in this report, that this issue rises to the level of one that should be, and it doesn't have to be a long, drawn-out effort, but my feeling is that it deserves an amendment to the town plan as to what new policy is regarding this, because this short-term rental thing has implications for retaining the character of residential neighborhoods, the stability of neighborhoods. It has implications for economic development. And to some extent, it may relate to affordable housing. I can explain why I mean that, but I won't go into it. I'm just saying that it cuts across a number of different items that are addressed in the town plan. And again, I'm not trying to make a mountain out of a molehill here, but I do think that when you have an issue where you have had as many letters as you have had, and as many people who have signed those letters, things can get beastly in Cornwall, but this has certainly gotten to that level where it's a little bit excited, and you've got people who are for, you've got people who are against, and you've got people who are in the middle of what the zoning commission should do. When something rises to the level of having so many people involved, I think it's useful to have a planning policy stated in the town plan that will guide how you develop the zoning regulations. And in this report, I cited the zoning regulations. One of the statement of purposes of the zoning regulation is that you look to the town plan in establishing policies. And of course, that's fundamental, but for the record, I'm recording all this. And other findings of of interest are that, and I alluded to this a moment ago, I don't see any town in northwestern Connecticut that's dealing with this in its regulations, or to my knowledge, receiving complaints and questions and having discussions at the level, certainly, that are going on in Cornwall. And I couldn't find, again, any regulations in our neighboring towns that would provide guidance, or for that matter, anywhere else in the state. And I note that, for example, there's three towns on Lake Warren in this region, Warren, Washington. And you know as well as I do, they're advertised all the time in the newspaper for summer rentals, spring rentals, autumn rentals, and winter rentals, be they short or long or whatever. And that has gone on forever, and it's not regulated. So I think what I'm trying to say about that is that, to a certain extent, at least in this corner of the state, regarding small towns, how you do this, A, doesn't give you a lot of guidance from your sister communities, and B, puts you in a position of trying to be the first one to tackle it and deal with it in a regulatory manner, if that's what you choose to do, which is what you're talking about. So it kind of raises the stakes. Concerns about those communities that have had to address this matter, which of course has been elevated in the public eye and in the zoning regulatory eye, is the fact that Airbnb is now worldwide, and so people are not just coming from the next town over or somebody's next door neighbor's friend or whatever, but they're coming from all over the place. So businesses can arise out of nowheres now, and zoning are often caught off foot on this, and I think this is the case now. Obviously, these activities have gone on in this community for many, 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 many years, as everybody has attested to, without any harm or foul, and so forth. But the increased intensity and exposure of potential clients around the world, changing Cornwall's very attractive community, so it's going to continue. I imagine it's going to continue to grow as a activity or use, and eventually these small towns are going to all probably have to do something in the regulations to address this matter. Just how soon that will be, I can't say. You all are being pushed into it perhaps a little sooner than some of them are. So you also have, finally, from Steve Byrne, and I talked to Steve, and I didn't know he was going to write this. He really didn't have much definitive to say on the phone, because he really hadn't thought about it a terrific amount. But I seemed to strike a chord of curiosity in Steve's mind as I spoke to him about it and asked about it. And he did go out and do a little homework, which I think was very useful. And he cites several communities and what they do and how they do it, and the difference between them. I will note that those communities are all relatively large communities, or even cities, at least compared to Cornwall, New London, Hampden, Richfield, West Hartford, and the like. And that's where we are seeing more attention paid to sooner than there are in the small towns. But we can learn something from those regulations. And Steve, I think, provides some pretty good basic advice, and I think he wants to think about it a little more. But his idea is that if you're going to formulate a regulation, and I'm not trying to get ahead of you, because you haven't decided just what you're going to do, but this is all a matter of discussing options and what to do about it and how to go about it. He talks about intensity as being the key factor. Intensity can, he equates intensity with numbers of bedrooms rented. But to me, it's also rate of turnover.
And so what, Tom? I'm sorry, didn't hear you.
Rate of turnover of clients or guests or customers or whatever you're calling. And of course, you have the matter of not just rooms being rent, but whole homes. I mean, so if the whole home is rented, it raises the question of, well, is every room counted as a room? That's the maximum number of rooms you could rent under this regulatory scheme and that regulatory scheme. There's all kinds of things to think about if you really get into fashioning a regulation that is focused on intensity. I'm not saying it's wrong, I think it's a good idea, but I am saying that it's going to require some thought. So that's.
Can I ask a point of clarification?
Sure.
Are you implying that the Planning and Zoning Commission would be inappropriate for us to propose a new regulation governing Airbnb without the guidance of a town plan? Outside of the town plan? Are we limited in terms of the regulatory changes we can propose by what's in the current town plan? That's my question.
No, the town plan.
Good question.
Yeah, the town plan is a guiding policy to the formulation of the zoning regulations, particularly regarding things like what kind of districts to have, where should they be, so forth and so on. But there's a principle here.
Mm-hmm.
But the principle is not mandatory.
Well,
so you do not have to amend the town plan.
Well, I have a follow-up to Anna, I think, because I was thinking the same thing. I'm just wondering if the town plan doesn't actually provide a certain amount of guidance, because it does speak about matters such as economic development and rural character being, you know, sacred goals. And so we wouldn't want to do anything that would clearly undermine the rural character or adversely affect economic development. I mean,
that was my thing.
Is there a difference between?
Yes, yeah, would be. So it does provide some guidance in how we, if we decided to approach some decision on regs.
To ease your mind on this, however, I think, and maybe the town plan could be a couple of paragraphs too.
Well, I'm also interested in if there's any difference in the process. So obviously, given the amount of input that we are already getting, this is an issue in which the town would insist on having the widest possible representation. And I think the process, when we propose regulatory change, is a public hearing. What happens if we propose a change or an amendment to the town plan? Is that also a public hearing?
Yeah, but you could do them simultaneously.
Okay.
Yeah, both of them.
So you'd have you'd advertise a hearing for both, first the amendment of the town plan.
Kind of like we did the.
We've done it before.
For the, what was it we did?
Stealth towers.
Well, the cell towers, we didn't do the zoning regulations.
Yeah, we only did the.
We only did the town plan.
Oh, we only did the amendment to the town plan.
Right.
Well. Did you want to speak about the options you had at the end there?
And I think that Steve's letter gives a little more meat to the nut about these options. And these are just options without a lot of detail of any particular kind of regulation, just the way you would go about dealing with it. The first one is following from what I just said. Consider amending the town plan on this subject. Do nothing under the zoning regulations till a policy can be formulated in the plan. And consider, in the course of your thinking, what's evolving in Connecticut small towns and how they're approaching this and finding solutions to it. And then you formulate a regulation based on the general guidance in the plan and best zoning practices as you can find them and get guidance from, as you already have your consulting attorney and myself. Add a new section to the zoning regulations providing that short-term rentals are a customary accessory use of a single-family residence in a residential zone. One could argue that it's been accepted by lack of action of enforcing a violation basis that the zoners thought it was allowed, then the only way I think that could be construed, and not improperly construed, is that it was looked upon as a customary accessory use of a single-family residence in a residential zone. Hasn't been clearly stated that way, but, so that's option, that's an option.
And can I just ask about that option too?
Yeah.
If the commission wanted to do that, how hard do you imagine that might be? In terms of, we're talking a regulation that has subsections and then subsections inside of subsections?
No, I think we would either go to, we would go to each of the residential zones and clarify that among the accessory uses that are customary with a single family residence in a residential zones are rental of rooms. And, you know, whether it also is rental of the entire home, I guess.
That sentence is nice and succinct.
Hmm?
Your sentence right here is nice and succinct.
Right.
Okay.
And I have a question about...
That's it, short-term rentals. Well, that's a short-term rental, what about long-term rentals? So I think you also have to address those and say that they're both allowed. Rentals, period. Mm-hmm.
I have a question about the relationship of doing something like number two to the ruling of the ZBA.
Okay.
Just
so
you know.
ZBA has ruled on a specific issue that has arisen, an appeal is made, they acted, you're waiting for that opinion. And you're going to have to decide to act on that opinion when you get it. However, I'm going to tell you that this still is going to come back to you as a policy issue that you need to address. Because although the ZBA has interpreted this, they've acknowledged by their own proceedings that it's not clear, that it took a struggle, that they couldn't point to the exact words in the regulations that gave them the ability to very clearly, and without any debate, say, this is the right way. Karen had to work very hard to come up with an interpretation. So they've interpreted an unclear regulation. It's your job to clear it up.
Can I ask a question about that too? I guess maybe it's kind of a statement as well as a question, but the ZBA's job was to interpret our regs. If we change our regs, it's changed.
That's cool with me.
Isn't that correct? And then if they were asked to do the exact same exercise after we change our regs, it's not the same for them anymore because they're interpreting our
right.
Right.
Okay.
Right. What happened in the past is gone.
Yeah.
At that point.
Yeah, that's the thing.
Okay, and then my other question is how will we proceed, do you think?
Well, do we want to hear about these other options?
Yeah, I mean, but after we, yeah, sure, fine. No problem.
Moving along, number three, add a new section to the zoning regulations that provides that short-term rentals less than 30 days are customary accessory use of a single-family residence in a residential zone, subject to certain specific basic requirements. You have to have a sufficient lot size, sufficient parking, adequate fire and other home safety improvements, limits on the number of renters. We could go on there. But that would be a use by right under certain provisions. Now, if the list of provisions gets really long, it's going to be hard to call it a permitted use. And that gets us to the next one. And the next option would be to add a new section to the zoning regulations requiring special similar, say, to the room and board and bed and breakfast, but perhaps with some additional ones because of the unique nature of these short-term rentals, or for that matter, long-term rentals. So those are the zoning regulatory classifications. And as I say, Steve's report gives you his idea that intensity of use, if you are going to regulate this, say as a special permit, or as a permitted use would be one category, where maybe one room is rented, or maybe two, and that's a permitted use, and if it's more than that, it's a special permit. That's what he was suggesting. I can see you shaking your head. There's a lot of things here to think about. No, to sort this out. The other item or approach, which is taken in cities primarily, is a local ordinance. And I included an ordinance out of the New York County, Otsego County, I guess is how you pronounce it, which involves many smaller communities and how they need to consider adopting a model town law or town ordinance on the operation of short-term rental units. And it's really rather robust in terms of all the things that happen.
That thing looked like a scheme for the county to make a bunch of money.
Maybe, yeah.
I couldn't believe that you could actually conform to every requirement and still run a business. I just couldn't.
It's just licensing fees on the yin yang.
Okay, so.
But I'm just adding to the discussion too, though, that in the legislature, there apparently is a move, as indicated in Steve's memorandum, and as I've read on the internet. There's a move on behalf of the Association of B&B Hotel and Motel Operators to require an amendment to state laws that would require that these home rentals become licensed and pay a tax and a fee, like a hotel. And that's a different matter, but that's going on, just so you know. Other people are paying attention to this whole thing.
Now, if we don't do anything at all, am I correct in thinking that Karen, at any rate, might be subject to a certain amount of heat because if we don't clarify anything, and we just don't act, I guess I'm thinking that's not an option for us one way or the other.
I would agree with you.
Yeah.
Well, it's an option, but let's say it's not.
Yeah, I don't think.
Thank you.
I think it's come to us to decide either this evening or if we want to speak about, have more time to think about it, the degree of oversight we want to have regarding short-term rentals.
I have a quick question for Tom. When you spoke to other smaller communities, were they kind of in a wait-and-see pattern, like obviously they're not looking at it yet, but they really want to know what we're going to do?
I think what's going on is that some of them just don't want to hear about it. They're pretending like they don't know about it, and leave me alone. It's just like they're thinking, oh my gosh, this is just going to be another big job. This is when you talk to the enforcement people themselves. When you talk to the policy people, like the mayor of West Hartford spoke out, you may have seen the thing I sent around, and he took the political position. You know, well, okay, we don't allow these, but we're not going to crack down on everybody. So, so much, it's hard for people to adjust to this change and realize it has to be dealt with.
For the record, I personally have spoken to many zoning enforcement officers, and even in my own town, my own, in New Hartford, the, you know, commission members have asked me to come speak. So, because it is an issue, I know.
So just because there's not other policies that we can look at as models, doesn't mean that it's not, that it's a unique problem, obviously, to Cornwall, that we're gonna be dealing with it, nobody else is going to down the road, it's more of, okay.
It's an evolving, you're the target of, by the good way to put it. I mean, I'll give you an example, Steve Byrne, as I alluded to earlier, when I talked to him, what I didn't say was that, you know, Tom, he has this annual meeting of all Connecticut planning and zoning agencies in March. And you have a nice dinner, it's a big place, and everybody comes, and he has a topic, and he has an expert come in to talk about it. He says, you know what? It's gonna be it. I think that's why it's homework.
I always give him subjects, I think winter ones.
So, am I concerned? Do you think, you know, among the commission here, I think, are we, am I correct in thinking that we're gonna either choose something resembling option 2, 3, or 4?
That's what I do.
He's got those circled. I have 2 and 3 circled.
I have 2, 3, and 4 circled.
Those are our options here, and we're gonna, no?
Not necessarily.
What are you?
I don't know what we're gonna do.
No, but what's the?
And the things that we talked about, never got to four.
But are, I'm not, you know, not as written exactly, but more or less.
It seems to me also that we might wanna think about people who rent a room in their house for either a short or a long term, as an Airbnb, say, and people who rent their entire house. Don't you think those things are different?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and,
yeah.
You know.
Absolutely.
I don't think they
don't. You know, why not?
I just think, if you're running a room in the, or you're giving a room or offering a room in your house, you should pay the same thing as anybody else. Why were you differentiating between bed and breakfast, whatever we're gonna do? It should be the same for everything. It's a business, they're getting income. That's my
But that's up to them to declare their
huh?
income.
What?
That's up to them to declare their income. That's not us, up to us.
No, but if they are, it's a business, okay? I don't care what you people say it isn't. It is a business.
Well,
if they're deriving income from it, it's a business.
I'm not disagreeing with you.
That's half right.
But perhaps they're happy.
One at a time? So.
I think that there's a difference, there might be a difference in our regulations for someone who is renting their whole house and someone who's renting a room. That's all I'm saying. Not that it's not a business and they're not getting income, but it's, there may be a different set of issues for those two kinds of things.
I think you're on to something here. Our experience shows that residential activities of a commercial nature in residential zones get people who live in that residential area, some of them anyway, their eyes are open and they're listening very carefully. When they hear that the owner is on the premises, they are much more comforted in the fact that things are not going to get out of hand, there won't be the noisy party, there won't be this, there won't be that, the excessive traffic, but, you know, things that could upset the neighborhood. When they hear this is all being rented out, or the activities being done with the homeowner off the premises somewhere else, that raises concerns. So I think fundamentally, from how people react to how you write these regulations, when that owner occupancy thing is in there, which it is for B&B, and it is for the room and board, but they're less concerned.
Josh, do you have a question?
Oh, I know someone who rents their house out on Airbnb, and he told me that Airbnb gives him a 1099 every year, federal taxes, they're, for him anyway, he's paying taxes on the money that he derives from his rental property. He's circumventing local taxes, lodging taxes, all that sort of thing, but he is paying federal income taxes on his rental money.
But he's not, he doesn't have a permit for his business.
No.
He doesn't pay a license. All of us who are in business, we have to have our license, and we pay for a license every year.
Right.
We have to have insurance, we have to have all the other things necessary to run a business. And these guys are running a business, and they don't have to meet any requirements, and there's something wrong with that, as far as I'm concerned. It's not right.
I got just a question of clarity. Is it planning and zoning's job to make sure that they pay their taxes and that they get the proper licenses and that they do all these things? Like, when we approve a home business, whether it be a hair studio or a kitchen, we don't go and make sure that she has a license or that she's certified by Torrington Area Health. We just approve them for business in their home, and that was it. We don't follow up to make sure that they're licensed or pay their taxes or anything of that sort. That's not our responsibility. Okay. So I think we should just, if that is correct, I think that's where we should focus and what we have control over.
I like the way Tom was talking about the intensity of the activity as something that maybe is something to look at. And when you cross the line from having a home to a home-based business or a business-based home, is basically what this is coming down. If someone has a high turnover rate and it goes on for a long period of time, then I'm not sure if I would be comfortable as a neighbor having that activity going next to me without any kind of repercussion or anything to, if you have basically a business-based home in a residential area. But if that is happening not as frequently, then I don't think I would have a problem with it. So it's some kind of, and I'm not sure if a 30-day thing didn't necessarily make a difference for me, as opposed to maybe 12 times a year or something of that nature, because someone might travel for the summer and they have a high turnover rate, but that's not necessarily something that I would want to cut down on or have a problem with. But if someone is doing this as their regular supplemental income and it's running a business out of their home and it's next to me in a residential neighborhood, I think I might feel funny about it.
No, so that would, I think, fall roughly under option three.
Oh, three, but it was less than 30 days in the parentheses, which I don't necessarily.
But, that's got to be sorted out.
You know, yeah. Roughly speaking, saying that they're basically okay, subject to certain requirements.
One other thing I just want to mention is, and I wasn't aware of this, it was a good time at the night to have the women board and then breakfast come up, because food isn't really something that we look into or regulate in our regulations for bed and breakfast. It doesn't come up as something that we look into, and yet that seems to be a large, people say, are they serving breakfast? And that's that seems to be a differentiation for a lot of people's minds, but it doesn't seem to be in our previous regs.
We don't, because we don't have that jurisdiction. The health department does.
Yeah.
Over the kitchens, over the breakfasts.
And Torrington Area Health has apparently said
that they're not looking at it.
That they're not.
They're not interested in looking at your
right.
Indian kitchens.
If you're just serving breakfast. If you're
less
just serving breakfast, they are not interested.
Okay. Just some kind of certain number of guests below which they don't care.
Oh, okay.
And above that, you're considered an aider or something instead.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, we would just to any regulation that we consider, we have to think about enforcement as a component. So we'd have to be, of course, sure that we'd be able to enforce anything that we some of our regs aren't enforced, but any of them that we have passed.
They could be.
In the, yeah, so we'd have to have a mechanism if there was a limit. We'd have to have some way of knowing, you know. So that would be a consideration.
David, are you entertaining any comments from the audience?
I'd like to hear from the commission first. Is there anyone else on the... I made the statement that I think we would be considering, roughly speaking, options 2, 3, or 4. I mean, I'm not, and there is the caveat, there's huge caveats, because each of them, it would not be as options 2, 3, or 4 as written, it would be broadly speaking. One of them, option 2, is basically don't regulate them. Option 3 is allow short-term rentals with minimal, but some regulation. I think I'm characterizing this hopefully fairly. And option 4 is have substantial regulation of short term.
Think of what it will cost us in terms of the public hearings alone.
Yeah, well, so, but anyway, I'm just wondering, am I correct in thinking that those are our options?
I think so.
But I think what James pointed out as far as intensity, or like what actually Tom pointed out, is a little bit more than just the amount of rooms that are rented. It's also the frequency. So I think that just needs to be worked out in whatever one we choose. I think we're going to elaborate on some more detail, I would imagine.
And to some degree, segueing from that, what that means is that we are going to come closer to defining what customary and usual accessory use of a home can extend to. Now, where does it segue into being what James is talking about, basically a business?
Yeah, like a bed and breakfast.
Yeah, what he is talking about, a
business. As opposed to still within that framework of customary and usual use of your home. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yes.
There have to be some limits, which is...
And then would you cross those limits to bed and breakfast?
Or a home-based business, if it's a rental.
Right. So we... That's
now,
to think about it like that.
Joanne, did you want to make a comment or ask a question?
Well, I'd like to make a small comment. I think the 2, 3, and 4, the way you looked at it, you know, is pretty accurate, except I wouldn't characterize 2 as don't regulate. I'd characterize 2 as don't change the present rules in Cornwall. I think that, you know, the language of renting your home is a use by right. When you talk about it being a business, as Peter and Derwin did, I mean, the fact is, if I own my home, I have, or I expect to have, certain rights that come with owning that home. And it's a residence. And if I live in it, it's a residence. If somebody comes up and stays in it, they're also residents of that house. Now, you can't have more than 6 or 5 unrelated ones. And so those are in your rules. But I mean, I think we have to keep in mind that, you know, planning and zoning and ZBA. And let me tell you, I was at the ZBA meeting, and if you read the minutes, you know that I was very concerned about some of the issues. It was very confusing. I am delighted to hear that you have Steve Byrne, who's an expert in zoning rules, because we got very confused over what was being said. And, you know, the fact was we couldn't approve our own minutes. And, you know, and what people might have meant to say is not what they said when they went back and looked at the minutes. So it is a difficult thing. But I would urge you, I mean, I think Cornwall has a long-standing history of rentals of all different lengths. I've rented for my family and visitors, and I think it would truly change the character of Cornwall if you put burdens on people's ability to rent their houses. I mean, what would Cornwall be if all the people who come here to ski couldn't have a couple days here? You couldn't fit all the people who were staying in these look, Amy just said that you rented 60 days, and I think there were 11 or 12 current listings on Airbnb. If they all rent for 60 days, that's 720 days of people coming to this town, spending money in all the other stores, and they have to spend money because there's nothing in the house for them. You know, and that idea, people are, most of these Airbnb are not rooms, they're whole house rentals. You know, and if, when my family comes, I don't want to put them in four different rooms at an inn or someplace. They want to be together as a family. And I think there are lots of people who do that annually in Cornwall. We saw that when we did the 275th anniversary planning. We saw it a date when lots of people come back to Cornwall. And I think it's a big part of the Cornwall history and socialization and all of that that happens. So I would hope that you would look at option two and take out the short term and just leave the word rental and don't change what has been customary and working so well in this town for so long.
Okay. No, I find that very confusing because you said when family members come to visit, you charge rent to your family when they're going to visit. You said you rented rooms.
I rented houses in Cornwall.
That's fine. But you said that the tradition of families coming to visit is not going to stop because of regulations.
Lots of us don't have big homes like you may have that can accommodate lots of family. So we have to rent other houses.
Dermot, I think, we should aim primarily to have the discussion amongst ourselves.
Thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you.
Can I say a few words, Dave?
Okay.
I realize you're early in the process, but already this issue has cost the town several thousands of dollars and some goodwill, and I wish you well in trying to make some peace. The only thing that I've reflected is someone who's in charge of regulating town activity in many different regards, it helps to keep your regulations workable and simple as possible. I was interested in the comments of the mayor of West Hartford, even though we're very different from West Hartford as far as how do you actually, everybody can come up with possible scenarios of what might happen, but how do you actually make these things work, I think is a very key point. And certainly the simplicity, ease of regulation, common sense should go a long way in whatever is come up with. I think also the town of Sherman, from what I understand, looked at the same issue and came up at the end of the day with a regulation pretty similar to what number two says. So I'll just put that little point out there as another town has looked at this and said, what's a really workable solution to what we're facing here? And what they came up with was trusting the townspeople somewhat self-regulating who they rent their places out to, and realize what the limits of a town authority are in such situations.
Thank you.
Amy?
Can I say one thing quickly? In Airbnb, if you were to rent a whole house out, there has to be a contact person who is there to greet the people and to answer their questions, get them settled. After they've left, there's somebody who comes in and cleans. So even if the owner is not there, there isn't like this continual parade of people coming all the time. And also, this is Cornwall, and you know, as I found out, there is not a continual stream of people wanting to rent your rooms. I mean, the other night I thought, gee, I better check, you know, my websites, my listings, see if it's still going, because I haven't had any requests for over a month, and you know,
probably going to continue for the next 5 or 6 months. So it just, you know, can get very dead. And I don't think we have to worry about neighborhoods, you know, being affected by this stream of people coming in on a, you know, nightly basis, you know, transients invading the tranquility.
And then if that, I mean, whatever we do, we're able to amend it also as circumstances change. So I think if we're in agreement that it's pretty much basically, I think a way I'm seeing us moving forward in this is at some point, possibly this evening, possibly not, us coming to some consensus of if we want to go basically in the direction of option 2, option 3, or option 4. And then after we decide that, we would ask Tom to come back to us with some recommended regulation. And that's how I see the process unfolding. Does that sound unreasonable to people?
Mm-hmm. That sounds good.
So then a question would be, is anyone uncomfortable with expressing a preference for option 2, 3, or 4 at this time, and would rather have another, you know, month to think about it? You know, if it's perfectly okay to be uncomfortable and to say, and to say we'd like more time, I like to go slow, but if no one, but if no one is on, if everyone is fairly comfortable expressing a preference now,
it's like a first date.
Then I think we're able to, you know, start that process. So is everyone comfortable expressing a preference?
Yes.
And so no one's uncomfortable. So why don't we start with Steve, since he always is happy to express his
preference. Could I have a point of clarification first before we go to that? Is it, do we have to specify short-term rentals in these?
You know, this is
a
workout session.
And, you know, how about if we don't get into too many details?
Oh, this is what everybody has to say.
We're going to try to be very, try to narrow it down.
Okay.
And whatever Tom comes back to us with, we're going to have discussion
okay.
about it
okay.
in any case.
Right.
So, Steve, are you willing to say something?
Sure. I appreciate your willingness to go slow. You know how much I envy that and appreciate that. But in this case, I'm going to go with the fast track. But anyway, I asked myself one question. I said, would this change the makeup of the town? And I asked that to myself because I think that's why we're sort of here, not to make sure, like I had asked before, that if someone going to pay their taxes. You know, that's not our job. Our job as planning and zoning is more what the town plan says. And so I'm trying to stay focused on that. Not, is it fair? Is everybody playing the same playing field? You know, is all the rules the same for every business? That's not our job, I don't feel. I feel our job is more planning and zoning. So I asked myself, would this change the makeup of the town? And I have to say no, I don't think it would. Based on what I'm hearing, that this has been a customary practice for a long time, people have rented out their homes, and the town still looks the way it looks, and everyone seems to be pretty happy with it. So, based on that, I'm probably going to lean a little bit more towards the option number 2. And however we decide to work it and mash it is fine, but I think that's where my direction is heading a little bit more, based on the fact of what our job is to do. I think as planning and zoning, you know, members here, I think we should try to stay focused on our job, not the rights and wrongs of the world.
I guess I've done what I do professionally for a long time with pushing 30 years and have gotten to know many, many second homeowners throughout that time period. And I've seen a lot of them rent their houses out on the QT, or I just did it because they didn't realize they weren't supposed to, for shorter, longer periods of time. And to my knowledge, there haven't been any grievances, huge issues with that. And I would, as a sort of property manager and things like that, I would probably find out about it and hear about it from these people at some point. And I also know for a fact that there are some people who own second homes around here for whom it's a big stretch for them to have that second home. I mean, we don't need to think about other people's economic situation necessarily when we're discussing this, but these are people that help out in town, and they volunteer for things when they're here, and they like being part of things, and they're people I think we'd like to remain here. And if them being able to rent out their house for a period of time here and there to help offset their expenses, if that makes a difference between them being able to stay here and yet another house for sale in Cornwall, then maybe we need to think about that too. And so I'm going to go sort of two-ish, you know, is where I am. Maybe some discussion about intensity, and if you hit a certain threshold where it becomes a really going business rather than an occasional or accessory usage, then we would have to address that.
Thank you. Anna?
I agree with my colleagues. I waver a bit between 2 and 3. I definitely know that I would be uninterested in imposing special permits for short-term rentals.
Okay. James? I spoke earlier, but I do like the option to have a short-term rental. In the past, I've rented out my cabin quite a lot. Not for short-term rental, but for a season rental. But I still think that our regulations actually spell out stipulations like for bed and breakfast, it seems like we're being a little two-faced if we require some regulatory aspect for that establishment or another business. But if somebody's going to have a home that becomes a business-based home, of just basically renting it on a regular basis and having it out, I don't know if that's something that we would want to look at, or how we would want to look at it. I think it's complicated and confusing, and I'm not settled on how I would react to it.
So would you?
So 2 or 3.
Okay. Yep, Joe?
I would go with 2. I think that 2 addresses Pearlie's concerns that something that's not in the regulations is actually not permitted. So if we put it in the regulations, then customary use will be permitted. And as someone who's married to one of the historians of Cornwall, I can tell you that people have been renting their homes and rooms in their homes in Cornwall since the middle of the 19th century. So it's customary.
Okay, Peter?
I'm going with 4. I still stick by it.
Okay.
I think we should have a level playing ground. Everybody else should be required for the same requirements.
Okay. Dermot?
Firstly, I apologize, Chuan. I misunderstood what you were saying. I thought you said you had rented a home, but you had rented a home for your family members. I too did the same thing a few times. I've rented space at the Cornwall Inn. I've rented private houses, you know, because of the space there. I rented private houses as well for family members for weddings and stuff. And I am going to go for option 4. You know, if you want to it's not going to change the whole family reunions, because you can rent from somebody who has a permit to rent, to let their house. You can still rent that house. Your family can stay there, and you know, and have it regulated, and that's the way it should be. So option number four.
Okay, and I guess I would. I don't know if the chair is supposed to express their opinion, but this isn't.
Can I have a vote?
This isn't an actual vote. I think there's some technicality that the chair does not vote or vote unless
it's a tie. This is a tie, you can break a tie.
This is,
okay.
This is a motion.
No, this
isn't
a motion.
It's not a motion, it's just a sense of the meeting.
Yeah, it's just a sense of
yeah.
The meeting. You know, the option four, if I'm correct, the owner, when they're operating a bed and breakfast, is supposed to be in residence. And that's a pretty, that's, if we adopted that for all rentals, that would mean that, no, you can't rent your home to someone else and go away. So that,
yes.
That would be a very substantial change in Cornwall.
You know, this whole, the home, I'm talking about option four for transient visitors. Not for, I think someone should still let their house for a month and go away. I think that's a totally different.
Yeah, nothing's written in stone. So I think we're
I think the whole month thing is too long a period.
Yeah.
I think.
Well,
you know,
okay.
I think we've got to
mash it up a little bit.
Mash it up more than that. But I think the 30-day thing is too long. Myself, somebody going away for a month should be fitting like a house, and it's a totally different thing than a transient, you know, one or two night stay.
Well, how about 2 weeks, though?
But it's like...
but 2 weeks is more...
You know what I mean?
I would stop it at 2 weeks. You know, I think the month thing is too long.
No, so anyway, I would, just to say, I would lean towards option two. And I'm very conscious also of implications in terms of enforcement, and I'm very loath to have us put in place a regulation that becomes hard to enforce. So anything that we do, I would want to you know, bear that in mind. You know, I think based on this, we seem to have a majority anyway of leaning towards two, with some possible concerns about intensity of use. So, Tom, are you able to take a crack at what something might be if it was option two? With some text that involves intensity of use.
I just would like to make a comment. I don't think, I mean, we just expressed our opinions here.
Yeah.
And I don't think Peter and Dermot are wrong.
No.
And just like I said too, that I like number two. It doesn't mean that I like it verbatim, and you know, it goes the same for Dermot, but just because he said he likes number four doesn't mean it's verbatim. So I don't think that we should rule anybody out because
that
happened to Dermot.
That's completely, and also that's a good point. And if you've seen how other regulations have occurred,
mm-hmm.
Like for instance, well, the mother of all regulations was the open space regulation, and that one there was a lot of back and forth. So whatever Tom comes back with, there's going to be a lot of discussion, and everyone is free completely to change their mind in any direction.
Yeah.
So, but this is just hoping to push the ball forward a little. That's the intent.
Again, Joanne mentioned about confusion and disinformation. And if you read the letters that was written in support and lack of support for the motion proposed by the Cornwall Inn and the motel, there seems to be a lot of confusion there, and a lot of people who wrote against the proposal seem to imply in the letters that the Cornwall Inn and the motel was trying to stop Airbnb, which they're not trying to do. They're not trying to stop Airbnb at all.
The motel was not part of it.
Yeah, but you know, it's in the letters. You know, people say that they're trying to prevent people from.
Now I'm hoping, I mean, if every don't want to cut people off too much, but we will have a lot of chance to talk about this in the future. If unless someone's uncomfortable with the direction we're offering to.
Other than time.
Well, aren't you going to be on holiday for a month?
Yeah, right.
Well, this is the perfect job. Yeah, yeah. Isn't this exactly what you want to be doing on Amelia Island?
Right.
So as a first crack at this, if we ask Tom to come up with something resembling option, between option 2 and 3, that you know had some text about intensity, that we'd be able to discuss again at our next opportunity. Is that a fair way of proceeding?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Well then, there's other items on the planning workshop, but I know Jim is comfortable. We just kind of touched base slightly about this, that, you know, something that Jim has been pushing, and I think it's a good idea, too, for us to have some discussion as to whether we ought to have a minimum square footage assigned to the residents. But I don't think we're going to discuss that.
Yeah, just to be clear, because since it's being videoed, it's that we currently have a minimum size requirement regulations that,
true.
That I don't think is something that we are necessary.
Let's not talk too much about that.
I will simply say that I think I have just about located the original opinion from Attorney Thomas Byrne that went to New Hartford, and I will have it for the next meeting, which is his recommendation.
So on the planning workshop is a January 23rd planning meeting. I'm not sure we have to talk too much about that because it's in the works. It's our meeting, you know, open to all the commissions and everybody in Cornwall who's working to help Cornwall. And in terms of the presentation I'm planning to make for planning and zoning, it'll just be telling people what planning and zoning has done in the past year and what we're thinking about doing in the future. And the component of talking about planning and zoning is going to be a fairly small component of this meeting. I'm not sure we have to say too much more about that.
I've gone in the past, and I won't be able to go this year. Mm-hmm. But it is sort of nice if we have another member other than just Dave.
I think if we don't have a quorum, it could be we're actually stuck.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I plan to be there.
Okay.
I can't always be there, but I can
so
be there.
So are we going to have at least 4 people who can go? I mean, Anna, Jill, me.
That's 3, we need one.
Where is this meeting held in Cornwall?
It's
January 23rd, a week from Saturday.
Okay, so we'll at least have a quorum.
I think it's 10. Come on.
Thank you. Okay.
Yeah.
So that's
you'll cool. Enjoy it.
When is that?
Yeah, it's
Richard will be taking it too.
Okay, well then the last item.
Oh yeah.
Okay, now we do have something else. I think we're actually obliged to do.
Yes.
Is the election of officers.
I think we are live, aren't we?
You should be doing it tonight, yes. Even though Tom and I are turning into pumpkins.
So we have to hear a nomination. We have to hear a nomination for chair.
I nominate Dave Colbert for chair.
I second that.
Or
fifth.
Well, thank you all. I actually, it sounds crazy, but I actually enjoy it. I'll say this is kind of maudlin, but I enjoyed working with all of you. So it's a good commission to work with, and to have the support of Karen and Tom and Gordon makes a large difference in how I feel about being chair. Believe me, if any of you become chair someday, to have that support makes a huge difference. There was a second for that nomination.
Yes, it was me.
Any discussion? I guess that's the only discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. So we need a vice chairman.
Just to remind everybody, it's been Jill this whole past year. It's been an onerous burden, hasn't it?
Yeah. Said it was so onerous.
Okay.
I'll have to take that.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And then we have a secretary, right?
Which is ridiculous.
Who's the secretary? Is it Jim?
It's Jim.
So,
I voted
because you
weren't
here.
Well, that's right. He wasn't here last year.
That's right.
That's how it happens.
Is there anyone who's very eager to be the secretary? Anybody? Someone does nominate somebody?
I nominate Josh.
Those two nominations occurred at the same time.
Who made the motion? Did you nominate?
Well, actually, we didn't hear it. So it has to happen again. Can I hear a nomination for somebody?
I nominate Josh.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Josh, are you willing?
I'm fine.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
You better state that, David. Stated that he's now secretary. Because it seemed to have been confusing.
So, Josh is now secretary. And last but certainly not least, I'd like to hear a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Is there a second?
There goes all kinds of seconds.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye, indeed.
Opposed?
Thank you. Congratulations.